Hello.
Hello.
Good evening. Hope you're all well. Hope I'm well.
I hope you are.
Yeah. At this very moment, I might be sat next door feeling very sorry for myself.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Lots of sympathy. Come on.
Well.
We've recorded this earlier because I've had an operation this week, hopefully. Hopefully everything will have happened. Been waiting quite a while for it. And thankfully got the date through.
Yeah.
And that should be me off for a couple of weeks at least.
Yeah.
So we've recorded today.
And we'll record next Sunday's as well. So, and beyond that, we'll just wait and see what happens.
You might just have to do it yourself.
We'll see.
Yeah.
So, welcome.
Welcome indeed.
Have a cup of tea. You can pause this if you like.
My goodness.
Up
yes.
to yourself. And, yeah, so this coming week, what will it be on? The food bank on Wednesday. And Friday between 9 and 12. We Care on Wednesday at 1:45. Band practice on Wednesday night at 8 o'clock. And next Sunday... Next Sunday, our in-person worship at 10:30. And then we'll be on here. It will be a recorded meeting, so it will be available to everybody on all channels at 6 o'clock.
On all channels. Oh, you're getting ideas of grandeur.
Absolutely.
Delusions of grandeur there.
Okay.
Well, shall we begin?
Yes, start at the very beginning.
Yes.
Heard it's a very good place to start.
Well, yeah, we're going to be thinking about Zacchaeus and the transformation that happened in his life as we go through this evening. So some of it's a bit tongue-in-cheek, as you would expect from us. But also some of it, we're thinking about the difference really that God can make in a person's life. We're going to start with 413. Number 413, come to the Saviour, make no delay. Here in his word, he's shown us the way. Here in our midst, he's standing today, tenderly saying, come.
Come to the Saviour, make no delay. Here in his word, he's shown us the way. Here in our midst, he's standing today, tenderly saying, come. Joyful will the meeting be, when from sin our hearts are pure and free, and we shall gather, Saviour, with thee, in our eternal home. And let us freely make him a choice. Do not delay, but come. Joyful, joyful will the meeting be, when from sin our hearts are pure and free, and we shall gather Saviour with thee in our eternal.
And let's just share together in prayer. Father God, we just thank you again that we are able to gather in this way, that we can come together, a group of your people, no matter where we are. We thank you, Lord, that we are all bound together by your love. Father, this evening, as we share this time of worship together, we pray, Lord, that you will be with everyone who listens, that they might enjoy the singing, they might enjoy the chat. But Lord, we just pray that they'll open their hearts to you as we look at your word, and may we learn something new of your love for us. Father, we just pray that you'll be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Dearie.
You know, every now and then, there's something that just annoys me just a wee bit.
What's annoying you?
There we go.
What was that?
Oh, what was being hidden.
Oh, right, okay.
There we go. That's better. Carry on.
Song 4-5-1. Song 4-5-1.
Well, that's interesting.
What's interesting?
I have to talk for a bit.
Oh, you could take the wrong one out. Oh dear. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear.
I've got this one.
Yes, I think you do. Yes, I'm sure you do have that one. Psalm 4:5-1 says, would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Would your evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. You're going to be able to play that now. You'll know if that's just it.
It will be at my usual level.
Okay.
Don't worry.
Psalm 4:5-1.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or even a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is blood.
I think that was better than my usual.
You think so?
Yeah, maybe all this practice nonsense isn't good for me.
Well, our scripture reading for this evening is taken from St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 19. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 19, and we're commencing to read at verse 1. Jesus entered Jericho and made his way through the town. There was a man there named Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector in the region, and he'd become very rich. He tried to get a look at Jesus, but he was too short to see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed up a sycamore fig tree beside the road, for Jesus was going to pass that way. When Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. "Zacchaeus," he said, "quick, come down. I must be a guest in your home today." Zacchaeus quickly climbed down and took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. But the people were displeased. "He has gone to be the guest of a notorious sinner," they grumbled. Meanwhile, Zacchaeus stood before the Lord and said, "I will give half my wealth to the poor, Lord, and if I've cheated people on their taxes, I will give them back four times as much." Jesus responded, "Salvation has come to this home today, for this man has shown himself to be a true son of Abraham, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save those who are lost."
Amen. So that's the theme for this evening will come from that, looking at Zacchaeus and the change that happened in his life. A change that not only can happen for Zacchaeus, but for anyone who turns to Christ. We're going to turn to another song now, number 421. Number 421. "Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?"
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in this soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Washed in the blood, in this soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
So this evening, as I've said, we're going to be thinking about Zacchaeus. And one of the first things that comes to mind when you think about Zacchaeus was his height, or rather the lack of it. Yes, yeah, so that gave me enough to actually think of. Let's talk about being vertically challenged. That's what they call it now, isn't it?
I think so, yeah.
Vertically challenged. Yeah. Well, how's it affected you?
Well, on Sunday, one of our ladies, it was her tea, we have tea after our morning meeting, and we have a rota for the tea.
We make people wait until the end of the meeting.
Yeah, we don't have tea. Not like here, where you can have it whenever you like. And so she said as well, "I've left the cups because I can't get them up in the cupboard." And I says, "Well, that's okay. I'll get them up in the cupboard." Mm. And she said, "How do you manage that? Because you're not that much bigger than me." Must have longer arms.
It's just enough, isn't it?
I know. And usually, like, so the shelves, so the cups go in this cupboard, but there's this cupboard with the mugs, and there's like the biscuits and everything, and then there's mugs up here.
And then there's mugs
right up. Not a chance. I can't reach them.
Uh-huh.
And Donnie laughs. He says, "No, I'm not taking them dinner for you."
So the practicality of things that are stored high up can be a real problem. Me, when I started school, I was the littlest one in the school. And it seems to have been a bit of a family trend. Ola was the same. There was her and there was another little boy who were the same height. When they started school, they were both the smallest at school. Seth obviously takes from his dad's
side. I was going to say, I don't think Seth's the smallest in the school.
He's not, definitely not the smallest in the school. But that was, you know, it didn't really mean anything to me at the time because I still had big attitude, although I was small. So it wasn't a big problem to me. It may have been to people round about me.
Yeah.
I grew out of it anyway.
Yeah.
The size anyway.
Well.
Maybe not the attitude.
Well, a couple of times. So first one was at college where I think I was standing behind the tallest person in the session.
Mm-hmm.
Thought I'd got away that nobody could see me. And we were singing a song and the training principal after the first verse said...
He was also a small person.
He wasn't very big. And he said, I can't see her, but I know she's there. So my hair must have been like that.
you had very big hair in those days.
Well, I still do. If I was to really let it, it would go... But I had really big hair. He says, I can see her hair. So maybe she'll read out the next verse.
Yeah.
And then there was another time we were
Alistair was about 6'5".
Yeah, it was 6 feet. Yeah, he was more than a foot taller than me. Yeah. And I must have had flat shoes on. Uh-huh. But even if I'd had heels on, you wouldn't have seen me anyway. And another time was a spiritual day. I think it was Lockerbie we were at. And I didn't think about it. I just sat down. And then the DC, his wife said, we'll stand up and sing. And I was standing behind another tall person, of course. And I could not see the screen. I ended up standing on the chair. And he kept apologising. He kept saying, I'll sit. And I went, no, it's fine. I can stand on the chair. I'll see it then. Mm-hmm. It's my own fault for sitting at the back, isn't it? I should have sat in the front row.
Yes.
Well, that was when I did have a problem sitting in the front row. I don't have a problem sitting in the front row anymore.
Ah, there you are. Me growing up, you've heard me speak often of Kenneth and Donald, my two really good friends from school days. Kenneth, sadly, is no longer with us, but Donald quite often will come and join online in our meeting. Both of them, of course, over 6 foot tall, and I am not. I'm a good 4 or 5 inches behind either of them. So quite often when the three of us would be out walking and, you know, we'd go up to the hills or even if we went into town, there would be one either side of me and talking over my head to each other, just making fun of the old guy because I'm 3 weeks older than Donald and a few months older than Kenneth. They would talk over my head, this little old guy that was with them. So, yeah, we had good fun.
Yeah. Last week, this has just happened last week, I went to get your yogurts.
Oh, yes.
And they were right on the top, right at the back. There is no way I could... It's happened before. Thankfully, Luciana was there the first time it happened and I shouted her because she is taller. Then I had to ask one of the guys. He wasn't that much taller than me either. He went and got a step and got it. But I just could not reach it. I'm like, no way. You know, and I'm up on my tiptoes. But they were right at the... If there'd been ones at the front, it would have been fine. But they were right at the back and I couldn't reach them.
So one of the things that we learned, having a young family back in the day, was when it came round to a certain time of year in December, that things had to be hidden away. And one of the best things to do would be to hide them high and at the back of wardrobes.
Yes.
Yes. Or up in the attic.
Yeah.
At height, which worked quite well until Erland was taller than I am. but that was it. Make sure that there was clothing put on top of things. And I don't know, I mean, they haven't confessed to having gone into a cupboard and found anything yet. But I've no doubt they will at some point. But that was what we found, you know, it was helpful being that little bit taller. But then again, I could always grab a chair or a step ladder and get up to that little bit extra height. Yeah. When I worked on a farm, for one of my holiday jobs when I was at university, the farmer asked us to, it was myself and another young lad, asked us to paint his barn. And since I was not the tallest one, the other guy went up the ladder and then was doing, it was creosote.
Mm-hmm.
So stingy stuff when it came on you. He was actually painting above his head and it was splashing down on him. And the farmer came along and noticed that, you know, he was, this lad was getting himself covered. He was afraid of heights, despite the fact that he was taller than me. So it was me who was then sent up the ladder to do all the high stuff at the height. So I just had to go almost to the top of the ladder and be as safe as I could possibly be then. I didn't fall off and I'm still here. So
you're still here to tell
the tale. There you are. Yeah. There's a way of getting things around most things, isn't there?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Any time when the being vertically challenged has been of your benefit?
Probably. I can't think of any just now.
Well, when we were at the music school, before we went to college, I was smaller than another person in the division, and we were engaged. And he and his fiancée were also engaged, and the two of us were up in the girls' dorm with Lynn. Was there as well, wasn't she? Your cousin? No. Anyway, the four of us, and not doing anything wrong, but we weren't supposed to be there. And one of the senior staff came round and was looking for any boys. It was time for them to be out.
It was the last night.
It was time for them to be out. And I fitted in the cupboard, whilst the other person did not. So being slightly vertically challenged was of benefit.
Absolutely.
On that occasion.
Absolutely.
Then I had to get out later on at night. And once things had calmed down, I just calmly walked down the stairs. The person guarding the young ladies was facing away from the stairs. And I walked past them and said, that's them. Well, calm down, and just kept going.
Days before mobile phones, of course. So I didn't know he was okay. Thought he's maybe been packed off home.
I wasn't. So, no time when you've actually been...
I can't think of any. There's bound to... There's bound to have been times when, yeah.
I know of one or two people who, because they're vertically challenged, actually are able to buy children's shoes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a bit cheaper for them.
Absolutely.
Than having to pay the adult price. Sometimes it works with clothes as well, and it's cheaper as well. But there you are. So, not always the most difficult thing. Your height's your height, and I think you get used to it. You know, there's times when I see taller people and think, that would be fantastic, and then I think, actually, not great. When I see taller people who may be struggling with their mobility.
If it's a low ceiling, that's good. Yeah.
Yes. Well, there was one of my problems when I was too tall. I was sent up into the attic of a solicitor's office in Cooper, working as a painter. But I also had my hair spiked.
Oh, right.
And as I painted along the ceiling, I then ended up with the white paint on top of my hair as well and had to go back slightly lower and paint it. So it doesn't always work in our favour to be too tall.
No. So, we're going to sing again. Song number 447. Who comes to me, the Saviour said, to him I freely give eternal life. Though he were dead, yet henceforth shall he live. His life shall be with gladness filled, his treasure is on high. Bright sunshine shall his pathway gild, and he shall never die.
Eternal life, though he were dead, yet ever shall he live. His life shall be with gladness filled, his treasure is on high. Bright sunshine shall his path regild, and he shall never die. The Saviour now will give, the Saviour now will give eternal life to all who seek, the Saviour now will give. Who comes to me, the Saviour says, that so well I supply, with portions of the living bread, which riches cannot buy. The soul shall never hunger more, but filled shall ever be with plenty from the filling store he ever finds in me. The Saviour now will give, the Saviour now will give eternal life to all who seek, the Saviour now will give. Who comes to me, the Saviour says, shall constantly partake. The stream that from the fountain bled, alone his thirst can slake. Who seeks in faith that fountain pure, his precious shall retain. Shall peace and happiness endure, and never thirst again. The Saviour now will give, the Saviour now will give eternal life to all who seek, the Saviour now will give. Who comes to me, the Saviour said, and follows where I lead, shall see my light upon him shed, and in my pastures feed. No more shall darkness cloud his way, my love his fear shall quell. The gloom that forms obscured his day, my presence shall dispel. The Saviour now will give, the Saviour now will give eternal life to all who seek, the Saviour now will give.
Well, thinking about Zacchaeus, he had choices to make. When he heard Jesus was coming to town, he could have just decided he was going to stay where he was and make a bit more money, but he didn't. He could have decided that he was going to try and push through the crowd. Well, perhaps he did, and was shoved back. So he made the choice to climb the tree and risk everybody making a fool of him, because he'd had to climb the tree. When Jesus called him down, he could have ignored him. When Jesus said he was coming to his house, he could have said no. And then he could have denied Jesus when Jesus said to him to change his life. Good choices. Have you made good choices?
Oh, well, I would hope so. Am I the Jew? Was that a good choice?
You tell me.
Probably, yeah.
Probably. On balance, it's not bad.
Yeah.
Is that it?
Well, I mean, life without me.
Oh, how awful that would be.
How awful that would be.
Yes.
Yeah, it would have been, wouldn't it?
Yes. Of course. But that was my choice as well, so.
Yeah. Good choices.
A good choice.
A good choice.
So what was a good choice about marrying me?
Because you're just so wonderful and you're just so good at everything.
Does that sound genuine? Honest, does that sound genuine?
You're it's a good choice. Well, I tell struggling. You, your mother will be telling, will be shouting that it was a good choice because she told me she's not taking you back. Of course it was a good choice.
Of course it was a good choice.
If we had got together, we wouldn't be sitting here, would we, doing this meeting? And
well, no.
So look at what all you lot would have missed.
That's not fair. Good choices, yeah.
Yeah.
Have I made some good choices? Well, obviously marrying you was a good choice. Wonderful choice. Genuinely a good choice, wasn't it? Yeah. I've been fed. You, at the moment, are jumping every time I ring that little bell.
I'm going to hide all the bells.
Yeah, I don't think that would be happening.
I don't think so somehow.
But it's something that we've, you know...
We've been through it with me.
We have. We've been through it a couple of times. And it is one of the good things that we're not on our own when we're facing that, you know, a difficult time. That there's somebody there who really does care about us.
Yeah.
And does want to make sure that things are... The good thing for you will be that you'll be able to escape as well. You're not going to be tied to the house. You'll be able to get out... The not so good thing is that you'll have a bit of extra work to do.
That's okay.
That's well. But there you are.
It's payback time.
Yeah. So having somebody who cares about you is a really good thing.
Yeah.
Other good choices then, apart from us.
I think one of the things at school was choosing subjects and was it the right subjects that I chose?
That was so hard, wasn't it?
Yeah. Especially when they put music and secretarial studies in the same column and I had to choose which one to do.
That was no problem for me. I didn't do either.
So I chose music. I chose music. And then I did secretarial studies in fifth year.
Ah.
And then I did the higher at night school thing.
Uh-huh. I struggled to remember the subjects that I did, but they were so important at the time.
Yeah.
Although, you know, recently I was able to use a little bit of German.
Absolutely.
When we had a Swiss officer in our meeting.
Absolutely. And then there's the whole thing of then when you go to leave school, the choices. Because I really didn't know what I wanted to do at the end of fifth year. I got to the end of fifth year and I wasn't even sure that I was going to go away from Orkney. I decided that maybe it was better to stay, but I was going to stay on to sixth year and bump up the number of few grades that I did have and the hires that I had. But this, I got the chance of an interview for a job, which I went for, and I got the job, so I didn't stay on to sixth year. And I don't think the choice I made was a bad one. You know, maybe I should have stayed on at school, but I don't think so, because then... I left school and went to work in the bank and then went to college. And then had the chance then to do further education, then to do a degree. So actually, you know, I didn't do it after school, but I did it like 40 years later.
But sometimes the choices that you're making as a teenager just seem to be so, so important. And actually, when you look back, they might not be quite as significant in the grand scheme of things. They're not quite as significant as perhaps they were portrayed at the time. It's important to do your best, important to get the qualifications that you can, important to be happy in doing those as well. There's an awful lot of pressure on young people as they're preparing for exams and such like, and their coursework. But also it's important to get a balance. And I think that's one of the things that might have been slightly missing to to an extent. It wasn't thought of as a significant thing within the education system back then. I'm hoping it's more significant now. I think there are a number of opportunities were given to us as young people. Good choice for me was not going to join Sunday League football teams. And that was hard at the time. That was very, very hard. I did try out for a couple of teams. And that was really difficult. That might have led to a different path entirely.
Mm.
Or it may just have been that I was redirected further along my path. And I'll never know that. So, yeah, I think a good choice then to follow in the way that was right. When I finished school, I had my university place and I had a couple of places too that offered me a university. But finding the right one was important. And staying at Dundee was not about staying at home. It was about having a flexibility within a course which I couldn't find with other universities. So that helped, but it also gave me the stability of being at home and gave me the stability of knowing the place and knowing people round about me who helped to support me through difficult times back then. So that was a good choice to stay where I was. And then to try and find what my life should really be about. And God has been speaking to me. So the good choice then was to answer that positively.
Yeah.
And it wasn't, you know, as I'd said before, it wasn't that I was afraid to leave Dundee. I did that just that little bit later.
Mm-hmm.
Having done my university degree, having had a year of work experience, then going to the training college, and not knowing really where the future would take us, but putting ourselves in God's hands, that was a very good choice, I think.
Yeah. And then in ministry, we've had choices to make, you know, I think particularly at Airdrie, where we had to choose things for the benefit of the core, which worked, you know, like we had to decide where we're going to go down the planned giving, where we're going down the road of natural church development.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was the choices of putting people into leadership positions, which thankfully all went well. And, you know, we it was a lot of prayer, a lot of faith went into that. And God really worked in that situation and in the choices that we made. And it was difficult then not to sort of tell people, this is what we are going to do. We presented it to the core and said, you know, you need to really pray about this.
Mm-hmm.
God worked in that place.
It would be nice to be able to just skip ahead on the tape, on the DVD, the whatever, you know, see how things would work out. There was a film a few years, Sliding Doors, a few years ago,
mm-hmm.
which followed two different paths of what would have happened if somebody got onto a train and if they hadn't,
mm-hmm.
and how different their lives would have been. And that is one of those things that I would almost like to see at sometimes.
Yeah.
How would life have been different? And we don't always pick out what are the significant, really significant moments in our lives. Every moment is significant because without it, you don't have the next one. But there are moments in our lives where we make choices which do have a dramatic effect on our futures and on the lives of other people as well. And we don't always see them coming. We don't always get to prepare for them. And we don't always get a lot of time to think about how we're going to respond in that moment.
Mm-hmm.
I think for Zacchaeus, this was one of those moments where he didn't know what was going to happen throughout the rest of that day and then the rest of his life.
Yeah.
There we go. Well, We turn to another song then. Song number 449. Number 449. Why are you doubting and fearing? Why are you still under sin? Have you not found that his grace doth abound? He's mighty to save. Let him in.
Why are you doubting and fearing? Why are you still under sin? Have you not found that his grace doth abound? He's mighty to save. Let him in.
Was that convinced Zacchaeus to climb the tree? I wonder what it was that convinced him to leave his post where he was making money. He was making a fair bit of money for himself. The Romans didn't care how much money he took off of people. They just wanted what was due to them. They had set the rate of tax for people coming and going from the city. They just wanted that. Beyond that, it was okay for the tax collector to line his own pockets. And I suppose Zacchaeus, being the little man, suffering from little man syndrome, which is a well-known thing, he felt that he was being picked on by other people, and he had found a way to make himself important. He had a good living out of what he did. Didn't care that he was collaborating with the enemy. He had a good job. He earned a good living. He might not have had that many friends, but then again, money is always able to buy friends, at least in the short term. That's what the prodigal of the parable of the prodigal son seems to tell us. The prodigal goes off with his money, has lots of friends while he's got money, and then no friends when the money's spent. Would Zacchaeus have found the same? Quite possibly. Quite possibly. But there he was, climbing a tree to find out what was happening. He knew Jesus was on his way. He knew that Jesus was able to perform miracles. He knew that Jesus was able to speak amazing teaching, and there was something very, very special happening. So he didn't want to miss out. Up he went, and he waited until Jesus came along, and Jesus stopped. I wonder how he felt in that moment when Jesus stopped. And then Jesus looked up and he realised that not only was Jesus seeing him, but everybody else round about was watching him up that tree. All dignity has gone. This was going to be a day that people talked about, as far as Zacchaeus was concerned, for years to come. The day when he had climbed a tree, made a fool of himself, when Jesus came along. And then to hear from Jesus that he wanted Zacchaeus to come down from the tree, and that Jesus wanted to come to his house. He was inviting himself as a guest to Zacchaeus' house. That must have been an incredible moment. Zacchaeus did not know what was going to happen next, but there was Jesus telling him to come down, and I'm going to come to your house. You're important to me, was what Jesus was saying. Not that anybody else in the crowd wasn't important, but this was an amazing opportunity. This was an opportunity for someone to have their life completely transformed. Sometimes we like to invite the right people to church. People that we get on with, people who we like, people whose lives are quite well sorted, actually. But to have somebody who is horrible to you, somebody who is basically stealing from you, and you can do nothing about that, to invite them to hear God's word, to invite them to have their lives transformed, I wonder how many of us would have chosen Zacchaeus to have been the one that we would turn Jesus' attention to. But there he was. Jesus invited himself to Zacchaeus' house, and the crowd started to mutter. They started to make their own choice about Jesus. For some of them, it was just too much. How can this person be the great teacher that he has claimed to be? How can he be bringing God's word to the likes of him? We know that he is a sinner. A tax collector in those days, the collaborator, was a special kind of sinner. Now it's a job. Then it was working for the enemy. The people who were taking over the country. Yeah, he wasn't popular. And why would Jesus be taking a message of eternal life to this kind of person? That just all seems so wrong. But then again, it's not about who we decide is fit for God's kingdom. It's about who he decides is fit to live in his kingdom. And Zacchaeus was given the opportunity to hear the gospel message. And he had the wisdom to respond to that gospel message as well. A response which was from his heart. A response which could be understood by the people who had seen what had happened that day. And a response that he was going to have to carry on through with. His life was transformed. No longer was he cheating people. In fact, he was trying to make reparation. He was trying to give back as much as he could. because he had found the most important thing in life was following God. He'd found that his money did not bring him happiness. His money was not enough. His life was transformed and he wasn't afraid to show it. He'd already lost his dignity by climbing up the tree. He'd lost his dignity even more when Jesus had stopped and told him to come down. Give him back the money. What's the loss in that? Because he had found something far, far more valuable than money. He'd heard the word of God and his life had been transformed. He had meaning, he had purpose in his life now. Dignity meant nothing. Eternity meant everything. For us, we can get ourselves tied up in all sorts of things. We're officers. We can get caught up in our rank. We can get caught up in privilege. We can get caught up in thinking that we're important or more important than other people. We can each get caught up in thinking we've got more right to be here than somebody else. But our real value is accepting our worthlessness and the fact that we need to come before God and ask him to forgive our sin. And then, with transformed lives, we can reach out to help others. We're not here just for ourselves, but here to be the hands of Christ, the eyes of Christ, the ears of Christ, the feet of Christ, making a difference in this world. What a wonderful privilege God gives us to have our lives transformed to be used by him.
Our closing song for this evening is song 405, 405. All have need of God's salvation, if with him they'd live forever. But a promise he has given, it is written, whosoever. 405.
All have need of God's salvation, if we think they'd live forever. But a promise he has given, it is written, whosoever will become, and who comes to him shall never disappoint and turn away. Praise the Lord, Jesus, whosoever. And this word it reaches nations, not the rich or learned or clever. Only shall by him be rescued. Oh, praise God, 'tis whosoever. For the poor and broken hearted, there's a hope and they need never have a fear about their coming. For the priest says whosoever, the sufferer will become, and who comes to him shall never disappointed turn away. Message but to all tis whosoever will they come, and to come to him shall never disappointed turn away. Case the Lord tis whosoever.
Thank you so much for joining with us again this evening. And we pray that you have a good week. And we look forward to sharing with you again next Sunday evening. Remember, again, it'll be a recorded meeting and it'll be available at 6 o'clock on all channels. Just like to put that in.
On all channels.
And let's just share together in prayer. May the blessed presence of God fill our hearts with the assurances of God's love. May the gracious arms of Jesus Christ embrace us as part of the community of believers. May the Holy Spirit baptize us afresh and lead us into newness of life. And may we always live in trust, knowing that we are God's, always and forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining with us this evening, and we pray you have a wonderful week, and you realise just how precious you are to God. Good night.
God bless.
God bless you.